Theron, can you tell us about very beginning when you worked at Rosicrucian Press and through your travels in Northern California, how you came to realize that the city of San Jose needed a museum?
Oh, of course, I was always interested in the history of San Jose, and I used to visit the museum out at the fairgrounds quite often. But I had been elected the president of the Landmarks Commission, and I traveled up and down the state in my job. I visit all these little city museums on the way. And one day I was in Kern County, Bakersfield, and I went to see their replica of a old town, and I figured that was the system that San Jose should have. It gave room for expansion and could handle larger crowds rather than just tour groups. And so I made up my mind that was a kind of museum we should have in San Jose, with only one exception. Kern County has their buildings 50 feet apart to avoid fire, but San Jose took the other course and allowed for fire hydrants and carried that way.
Did we have a location in San Jose already, or how did you come about realizing where this museum would be placed?
Well, it fell on that because it seemed like when people were coming to San Jose that the various units should be close together. Kelley Park and the zoo and the museum should be handy to each other. And so they had this 15-acre plot at the south end of Kelley Park. There was nothing but a weed patch at the time. And we decided that, as the Landmarks Commission decided, that was the place it should go. But we were immediately opposed by the Planning Department and the Parks Department, because the Parks Department wanted jurisdiction over the land and the museum, and the Planning Commission, no idea was good unless they thought of it. And so from there on, it was a long argument and before the council and different committees and so forth. The council asked the Planning Commission for a report, and they made the report all right, which I knew about and had a general idea of the content, in which they turned down the request for the site because they wanted to put a zoo there. Anyway, they made the report, and it was an adverse report. But they didn't return it to the council. So after 15 months of waiting for them to put the report in, I went before the council and requested that they asked the Planning Department to issue the report within 30 days, because it was already written. All they had to do was hand it over. And so anyway, they did that, and at the meeting, there was discussion between myself and the planning director, and when they came to we finally got to a vote of the council, and we got approval by a 6-0 vote. In those days, the council only had 7 members, and 1 member was absent. So in theory, we got a unanimous support from the council.
At what point, I understand you and Ernie Renzel had some conversation. At what point did you and Ernie Renzel have conversation about purchasing some the Bohnett Collection for the museum, to had an opportunity to enlarge the museum and get a very large collection? How did that come about?
Well, Lou Bonnet, of course, he was a collector of junk, as the town said, but he'd buy anything, and did everything from undertaking wagons to anything you can imagine, paintings, and he wanted to move, and wanted to sell the collection for $250,000. That was his asking price, and I went out. We went over very carefully and took an oral inventory of it, of which I have a tape recorded of it. And I figured the price was about right. And so then I went to the city manager of Dutch Hammond and told him the proposition, where it stood. We get this collection for $250,000 or less. You know, I knew there's certain things I was going to eliminate. I didn't want to buy it. And so he says, well, he didn't give me an answer right away, but he later told me, he says, well, he said, we don't have $250,000, but if you can get somebody to buy it and hold it, we'll buy it from for $50,000 a year. And so he left it up to me. And so there I was. I had approval, but I needed $250,000. And so I thought back of who did I know that had that much money. Well, of course, Ernie Renzel had been very active, and he was in the original purchase of the Kelley Park, and he also originally purchased the airport held for the city and sold it to him at no profit, just for the promotion of the city. So I had graduated high school with Ernie, and so I decided I would tackle him first. So I went out to him, and he had a beautiful antique office and so forth, and he passed a few moments of the time of the day, and then he got right down to business and said, well, what can I do for you? Because I haven't seen him in 20 years or more. And so I explained the deal to him and said I had to get somebody that would buy it and hold it for the city that way. And he said, is it worth it? And I said, my estimation, yes. And so he kind of looked around the city a little bit, said, okay, I'll do it. I don't think the whole conversation took 90 seconds. And so he did. And the big problem now is that they still don't have enough buildings or room to display all the collection. About more than probably half of the collection is in a warehouse on Stockton Avenue, which is too bad, because it's probably over there is just deteriorating from natural decay. But that's the way that started.
Well, that's interesting. And that's why the purchase of Beechnut right now is so important, and telling our story of the past and where we are now and where we're going in the future, and storage of some of this collection, this Bohnett collection, which is very special to the museum, that will be stored there. One other thing that you did is you influenced the city in purchasing the Peralta Adobe.
Well, when I was on the Landmarks Commission, I had four objectives. One was to get the museum, and the other was to get the Peralta Adobe, and one was to see that the Roberta Adobe was taken care of, and another was to get Clyde Arbuckle to write the publish the history of San Jose. Well, we got the museum site settled, and I had one problem with the Roberta Adobe. We didn't have much. The Roberta Adobe at that time was in the county, and so that was a slight problem. But when they put it through Highway 280, they had the highway go right next to the building. and they'd have to tear down the building if they put the highway through 280 through. So I went to the, as a matter of fact, they came to see me. I told them that was a very important building and it shouldn't be destroyed. And so they figured out that in purchasing the right-of-way, they already had land to the north of the highway. So they moved the highway 15 feet to the north, and then on that corner of the building, they have a vertical bulkhead instead of a slanted one. So that gave them a total of 30 feet clearance between the building and the highway. So that went through very satisfactory. And then eventually the owner of the building died and Gene Venom took over. He took an interest in it and he promoted, got somebody to restore the building, which cost, I think, about $300,000. And he did a beautiful job on it and it's still there. And anybody who wants to go to see it, they can walk around the grounds. They don't particularly like you to go in the office. A couple of lawyers are in office there now. But you can go walk in the back, which has probably the largest grapevine in the county, is in the back of the building.
Well, John Verzoni was the one that restored the Adobe San Jose businessman.
And then the city also approved giving Clyde time to write the history of San Jose, and he had a few problems. He had a sick spell and so forth, and the book was several years in coming out, but it was very successful. And then on the Peralta Adobe, the Peralta Adobe is the oldest house in Northern California, and of course I had a little history that Giannini lived there for a while, and it had quite a history, and it was located in town, and it'd practically be impossible to move an adobe building. And Councilwoman Schaefer, she took quite an interest in that, and I asked for just the purchase of the lot where the house was. And she went further, and she promoted and had it passed that the lot next door and the lot in the back were also purchased. So that made a beautiful setup for the building. And of course, it is operating as a part of the museum at the present time, which is too bad in a way because it takes employees that should be, that are needed at the museum and the staff the Peralta Adobe, but that's the way things run.
You said Council Member Schaefer, was that? Theron, as an avid stamp collector, you were instrumental in getting stamps with the Peralta Adobe and the Coretta. How did you go about doing that?
Well, the Postal Service usually puts out stamps for states on their centennial year, and so that they had been working, they usually work a year or two ahead. And I was in the post office one day, and they had a circular of stamps that would come out during the following year. Of course, the California stamp wasn't due until September, but this is Christmas, before Christmas. I looked at the folder, and lo and behold, the most ridiculous design you ever saw in your life. It showed a great big two-story mansion and so forth, and gosh, when they came here, there was nothing. So I wrote, as a matter of fact, I remember it was a four-page single-space letter of the history, the background of San Jose, and sent them a couple of pictures I had, and so forth. and the design was all wrong, and historically incorrect. And so they immediately replied and got some information, and they put the artist in touch with the artist that drew that picture up there. And redesigned the whole stamp to the present, the one that was finally issued, which featured a picture of the Peralta Adobe, but they changed a little bit. They said they didn't want to make it exactly the same for some government reason, I don't know. But anyway, they did change the design to conform historically with the stamp itself. So, and the city.
And this is the picture of the stamp right here, the Peralta Adobe. They took, the artist Earl Thollander took a little license with it, but it resembles the Peralta Adobe very well, I think. And at that time, the stamps were 13 cents, first class. And the Coretta.
Then immediately when they got that out of California out, the post office had a series running of transportation, old time transportation, and so of course back east they never heard of a Coretta, and so I started working on that in 1983. And it took 6 years to get it through, and where they finally issued a 7.6 stamp, coil stamp, with a picture of a Coretta on it, and they held a first day sale at the museum, and I also had some other covers there, and the museum told me at the time that was the largest income day they'd ever had. On the first day cover. So.
And this is a picture of the first day cover. And Washington, D.C. officials from the post office flew out for the dedication. And we even had two Corettas from the state.
Landmarks Commission?
Yes, I served two terms and then ended up as president of the Landmarks Commission. And Theron and I are the only husband and wife team that ever served as chairman or president of the Landmarks Commission. And during that time, they were exciting years. We had the dedication of the Peralta Adobe, and I would give slide programs and lectures, and then I taught local history at De Anza College. And then also supplementing the lectures, I would go out to the community and we'd have a walking tour of Santa Clara, San Jose, and Mission San Jose, Saratoga, and all the outlying communities. But I always emphasized the San Jose Historical Museum, and that was always included in the tour. And also, I worked with different historical societies outside of San Jose, and I also took them on tours of the historical museum, everything to promote the historical museum. That was our first love at that time.
You authored some books. Can you tell me about some of the books that you wrote?
I wrote Luis Maria Peralta and his Adobe, and it was a story of the Adobe and the restoration. I dedicated to Theron, who had the city purchase the Adobe, and Leonard McKay that started the restoration of the Peralta Adobe. And it came out in hardback. Smith McKay printed it, 800 copies, and several thousand of the paperbacks. And the big highlight of that, to my way of thinking, is that it was given to President Ford when he was here at a luncheon, I believe it was in 1976. So Ralph Rambo did my illustrating. We were both invited to the luncheon, and we shook hands with President Ford, and it was given as the official gift from the city of San Jose, along with one of Ralph Rambo's maps. And it was a very interesting, enlightening experience. They had security on top of the St. Clair. It was held at the Civic Auditorium at that time. And they had security and library and all over, and we had to produce our credentials. It was a very gala and exciting moment in our lives, both Ralph and my life. And then I wrote another book on land grant to landmark, and John Brazzoni asked me to do that. He did the restoration of the Roberta Adobe. And so both of those are on sale at the San Jose Historical Museum gift shop, although the Peralta Adobe is almost out of print now.
You participated in a documentary, Valley That Was. Can you tell me about that?
Yes, I did. There was a Louise Henry that had a grant to do a documentary on the valley like it used to be. So she came over, and I gave her a great deal of information, and I acted somewhat as a consultant. And later, she won a prize for the best documentary in 1977 by Public Broadcasting. And I believe she went back to Washington, D.C. or New York City, I forget which, to receive this coveted award.
Francis, tell us about some of the historical organizations that you are involved in. I know you're involved with O'Connor and how you got involved there and with the pioneers and offices you've served and what you are doing ongoing with the museum and association.
Well, back in the 1970s and 80s, I was very active. I was president, past president today, of the O'Connor Hospital 89ers, which at first honored pioneers, but now we have different goals of buying equipment for the hospital. But I still attend meetings. And then I belong to Saratoga's Historical Association, and because I edited Saratoga's first 100 years. And I was active as speaker then, but this goes back, and I've dropped out of that. And I belong to the Pioneer Society, and I do attend some of their, they have bus trips. And I'm always trying to promote the historical museum. And then I belong to a women's club, Tokalon, and we have gone out to the museum and held luncheons there and also acquainted the various Santa Clara Valley people with what we have at the historical museum. And then the Peralta Adobe, I'm on their committee, but I have not taken a real active part in that at the present time, which I have in the past. And whenever I have an opportunity, I always try to stress San Jose's history and also tell people we're the first civil settlement in California. And for many of my involvements, I have been received awards. I received awards from the History Center at De Anza College and also from the Pioneer Society and State Historical Society. And, there are numerous. They're all kind of intertwined with one another. And the last one I received was from the Soroptimus Club, even though I'm not active now, but they felt they should give an award to someone that had been very active in the community in preserving our heritage. So I received a beautiful plaque and voted a Lady of Distinction along with about six other ladies. So that was the end of that. And whenever I have an opportunity, and I still continue and talking about the museum and looking forward to the big party in September, and which I think is just a wonderful idea to let the community know what a jewel they have out there. And then, of course, the Peralta Adobe, that is one of my first loves. And Roberta Jameson, too, she worked with me on the Peralta Adobe, and she's looking forward to coming down. And she was inspired this Junior League to vote out $15,000 for a teacher's kit. She would be very instrumental in that. I helped with that. Then I was on the book committee, so every year we chose a book as a premium for joining the museum. But I haven't been on that for the past 2 years. So that still concludes, and Theron and I received many similar awards from our involvement. In fact, he received an award from the state legislature commending him for preserving our local history.
Clyde, can you tell us about being historian for the city of
how
San Jose?
How we helped me get this. All right. Appointed. Now, I was born into a house full of bookworms and a house full of pioneers, real pioneers who came over in 1846. The Gordons, the Lairds, the Piles, the Whitemans. They were all my people, my mother, on my mother's side. Well, anyhow, I heard all these stories from my elders, and I thought nothing about it. They thought it was only a way of life. But I later on found a little magazine called the Pony Express Courier, and I began reading that and had the stories. So I kind of knew no money in it at first. And I began to write little stories for them. And then the stories got longer and almost book length. And then one day something happened. I was speaking to Dr. Hubbard, who was the director of curriculum of our county school system. And he said, Clyde, he said, would you care to give us a story sometime? I said, sure. He said, well, the Institute is coming up, and I'd like to have you. And he said, I'd like to take you on three or four areas and see what you can tell me about them. So Helen remembers, I ate lunch somewhere else. We went to Palo Alto and looked at the tree, Palo Alto. We looked at the Mountain View, we looked at the other places, and then we filled our there, and then we came down to Los Altos, Cupertino. We told how on they went to Cupertino, and so, and after the several tours were over, Hunter said, you did fine, and he said, now we'll take the paper. And so for about 6 weeks, every Saturday, we had a Greyhound bus or another chartered bus, and I took them to each one and explained what they were seeing and what historicity it had. So that was fine. On one of those superintendent schools in San Jose, Earl Crandall had he started to ask me some questions. And then another one from Camel High School, who was as wrong as if he'd burned his only shirt at that time. And I got a call from Crandall. He was a neighbor of ours. He's just on the street behind us on Kirtner. He's on Kirtner, we were on Franklin. And he said, you should be teaching. You should be teaching. Well, all right. I don't think I'm qualified. But anyway, the next thing I know, our phone rang. And it was David McKay of the adult education. And he said, Clyde, what are you doing? I told him, well, McKay
I think it was Crandall that tipped him off. Mackay called up and he said, Clyde, he says, when it's convenient for you, I should like to see you come down to my office. I think we have something to discuss. Didn't occur to me. So that was in about August. And I didn't go down till September. Then one evening, Helen was going to a meeting of a ladies' club downtown. And she said, I said, what time shall I come and take you home? We had only one car then. And she says, oh, I think she was going to the meeting. She says, I think an hour. I said, all right. Then when I got down to the sidewalk, we were on First Street, I thought, well, that's going to be a long wait. And I'll go to see Mackay. So when I went into Mackay's office in the old high school building, found him at his desk. He was wearing the buck, and he had his eye shade on, like an old newspaper editor, and he had been one of my senior dentists. So, anyhow, he was on the phone, and he motioned me to a chair, and he talked some length of time. I was afraid I wouldn't get back in time for Helen, but she found out that it was all right. And he put the receiver down at the end of his conversation. He says, well, I see you found it convenient to get here. It was good. And I said, yes. Well, he said, how'd you like to work for me? Who? Me? Yes, yes. I said, well, here's for you. Teach history on the immigrant trails. And I said, in particular, well, he said, the high country. That meant the Rockies, Wyoming, and those places. So I said, I don't think, never given any thought. Well, he said, give it some thought. The September, the semester was nearing an end. Well, it was Christmas time was coming. And I got a notice, a report for service in January of that year. So I reported, and I was the first thing I had was Santa Clara County, that is in the high country. I was repeating all those places that I took more, and I have we have books all over the house. So we went, I think, the first time up to Palo Alto, because Portuguese came there as the first exploration by an Anglo-Saxon. And so we went up there, and then we visited Palo Alto. We went around Stanford and cut in the north part of the country. The next time we were over around Saratoga and Los Gatos, and finally we circled the whole county, and he constituted a case on the county. It was all right. I didn't get killed. So he said, well, he said, we'd be ready next year. And so the next year, we went abroad. But abroad wasn't very far. We got down to San Juan and some of the other places. And then, then one evening, while I had the projector going, looking at the scene to see if it's in focus, I saw the door to my room open. The old high school had windows in the door. And out of the light in the end, the door opened, and I saw a shadowy going back along the wall of the room. And when he came over, he whispered in my ear, he says, Clyde, he says, when you get through, come into my office. So he needed the intermission. So I went to his office, and I thought, well, here's where you get it. I did something wrong. And went in, he said, Cy had a stroke this afternoon, and we don't know what it, that was Sylvester. And in the Well, the man that had the stroke never came back. But if I look in his word, I would be, you know, and I said, he said, I want you to take a science class as well as a run. That'd be 2 a week. And I said, he said, can you do it? Yeah, I said, yeah. But I said, what do you mean by the high country? He says, the Rockies. He says, what state? Well, he says, he was on Wyoming and intending to go to Montana. And he says, do you think you can speak on it? Well, I said, I can take a chance at it. So I took that, and then another class and another class till I had 5 classes a week.
What year did you become the city historian?
Well, I taught for the from 1947. Let's see, Mackay, 47, 57, 67. 77 and 80. So I went to work for him in 47 or 81, and then I left my last class. I left for 1888. I retired.
Tell me about 1950. You were the curator. In 1950, you were the curator and director of the museum when the museum was located in the State House. And we had a collection.
We were still in the State House then.
Tell us about
being curator.
And the collections that we were collecting and how the museum was growing at that time.
All right. In 1948, 9, and 50, the State of California put on a program that was called the Centennial Period. The 1948 was the centennial of the gold discovery at Coloma. There'd been other discoveries in California before that, but that was the discovery, the one that started things. And then 1949 was the gold rush. That's another centennial. And then 50 was the creation of statehood. And so I was working there on a job for an outside outfit on that. But in the meantime, I was watching my smaller thing. So I got to, I was on the 1950, and I took my part to just sort of handle it, and explained it. I really explained it to the students, and they got in on some of it, and that was it. But they had to have a prop, because they had the State House had a centennial and had more than time. They decided to build a replica of the State House. Those on the committee, you ought to remember this. The people around town donated the materials. The commission had no money to speak of. The commissioners weren't paid, and I wasn't paid for the city. So the merchants in Santa Fe were exceptionally generous. They preferred. You remember how the merchants donated the and they had the replica of the State House. It
Can
was
you
a building
tell about this,
replica.
This picture and all yes. of the artifacts and was, in here?
You ought to have an outside one there so I can show that you. I have the outside electronic. But anyway, the State House was to be a museum. Well, where were we going to get the gifts? Where were we going to have the material? Well, ever since the commission was put together, the people began giving it. They were emptying their houses. Charlie Payne took a lot of stuff to his home, and the other men, Dr. Rode, Ernie Weller, they all took stuff to their homes until finally it was getting bad. But then this thing ended. We maintained an exempt. The members of the commission would serve each one day or two. So that was all done that way. But what are we going to do all these things now with stuff? Well, we know the city gave us permission, the commission gave us permission to leave him in there. Well, finally, about 1951, Harold Flannery, the city engineer, today he's the director of public works, I believe, he will have it gone. But Harold said, you fellows will have to get that thing off there. It was right across from where the Fremont Hotel is. So he said, you have to get it off. He said, it's killing the lawn. We'll have to move it. Well, then Russ Pettit, the manager of the Chamber of Commerce, he also was a big wig in the county fair. And so Russ Pettit brought it in. He says, take it out to the fairgrounds. And that's how we did it. Russ Pettit did it all as superintendent. He got a house moving to it. One house mover told Russ, he says, you're my friend. I'll move that building for a huge sum. Not a huge sum, but a sum. Well, Hud, Russ, he thought the sun was exorbitant. So Russ talked to Kelley, and Kelley, a house mover for years, and he moved the house out for half of what the other was in, and then I think he gave half of that out. He was very generous. So that brought it out there. And then, now what are we going to do to have it? Well, we have a storage place for all the things that we've been storing in our home. So we got them all over there. We arranged them. And by that time, Santa Fe High School was getting ready to move. And they moved, and they, let's see, what was it? Santa Fe High School gave us all those long tables, which you remember also. They used them in the high school. You could even place them under the rest of your feet. And they took them all in there, and these are those tables. They were about, each table was about as long as from here to the light, from where I sit to the light. And we had our blessing in tables. And now we had to get them out of it. Well, then how are we going to operate it at a point? Well, you have to be somebody here to handle this stuff, meet the public and so on. And that's when they put me on. I put on then, and I worked then till 1988. I was under that. But
you were a
member. No, I taught the 1988. Pardon me. I didn't work. I left there sooner. But anyhow, this is really the thing that I can name. There are a lot of these people I named, and all the part. But they had this room, and a big room that was the whole upper floor. You had a staircase. Back of me here, going up from the entering room, the first room, and so we go up the staircase. And
this for the future?
Well, I certainly do, and they deserve them to date. right along. This place has come along, and it's a beautiful. It has serving its purpose, and I think its personnel have done, each and everyone has done well. In the time I have seen. It's a park.
Ernie, your involvement with the city happened many years ago, your civic involvement as mayor of San Jose. When were you mayor, and how did you get involved in serving your city?
I was born in San Jose in 1907. My father was born there prior to that, and my grandfather came here in 1855. So we've been in this community for a long time, but we went in 1944 on a reform ticket. Six of us ran as a group, and we were the city council. So one of the first things we did as council was to form a historical landmarks commission. And currently, this is part of the historical landmarks program. I think it was important for us to remember that San Jose had a great past, it's got a great present, and it has a great future. And I think that this particular Kelley Park should be the centerpiece for San Jose for its recreational values, as well as a nice place for young people to go and be happy.
You were instrumental in adding to the collections and archives in the museum in 1967. Can you tell me something about that? You and Theron Fox together were able to add to the museum's collections.
Well, I really have to talk to Theron Fox about it, but you're talking about the Bohnett Collection. Well, Bohnett had a real interesting collection of stuff. Trouble was, he was always running out of money. So I went to see him at the Dutch Ham and said, go talk to him. So I did. And as a result, we bought the collection. But we paid it off over a period of 4 or 5 years, I think. But the city, I think we financed it somewhere or other. I forget the details. But it's a very nice collection. It's really good stuff. And it is part of this museum complex.
Can you offer good wishes, well wishes to the museum for its future and where we're going in the years to come?
Well, of course, it pleases me that this historical museum has been such a fine thing for so many young people. I'm thinking you're in the background here, these kids. But this is only the tip of the iceberg. This complex can go all the way to Morgan Hill with the Coyote Creek Freeway and Parkway. But I see this as being right in a class with Golden Gate Park in San Francisco. It's got lots of room, and the main thing is that it's got the nucleus for development of a very, very fine park for the people. Not for me, not for you, but for all the young people and the community itself. Okay? And wish that nothing more well to my
state. I think my interest began because my father's family were early pioneers in San Luis Obispo County, and they had come overland. My great-grandfather came overland from Upper New York in Canada in 1862, and my great-grandmother, whom he married later, had come in 69. She remembered the railroad and the seeing the tracks, and they were building depots and so forth. So it had to be in 1869. So I don't go back as far as Clyde and some of the others, but my interest was, you know, piqued by stories that I heard about great-grandfather Jada and, you know, the ranch and so forth, which is where he farmed is now a county park. And anyway, then when I came to San Jose, I went to San Jose State, and I majored in journalism as a minor in English, and as soon as I got out, of course, I I was looking for a job on a newspaper, and there was an opening on the Mercury, but I'm a morning person, and I lasted about 3 months on the Mercury because I had to go to work at 2 p.m, which is about my nap time, and didn't get off till almost midnight. So I transferred to the news, which got me down there at 6:30 in the morning, and that was just fine with me. Anyway, not too long after I started to work on the paper, which was in 1943, after I graduated, I started going to classes taught by Mr. Arbuckle. And I got more and more interested, and then when I would see little things would come up that had a historical significance, and so I would write about them. And I would submit them, and they started using them. They didn't tell me to do these things, but I just couldn't keep my hands off them. So then I started calling Mr. Arbuckle, and he became my great source. And I've always felt that I owed my entire career to Clyde and Theron and some of the others that had helped me so much in my beginnings of writing about history. And then I started going on these trips with Clyde and the adult education program. And then one day the editor said, "Pat, we would like to do a historical feature once a week, and do you have any ideas?" And I said, "Well, you know, I've been studying the history of San Jose, and because it was the first civil settlement, the first state capital, and there were so many pioneers that settled here, that I've been looking at the street names, and so many of the streets are named for these pioneers, and I would like to do something on the street names." So they decided to call it Signposts, and so for exactly 10 years, I wrote a column on one of the streets, not just in San Jose. I did the entire county, and I even went up to San Francisco and down into Monterey and nearby areas. And then I retired in 1983, and just before I retired, the Mercury had put together about 60 of these signpost articles into a book form, but they never got around to publishing it. So they gave it to the museum, and the museum published it, and then a couple of years later they published another one, which we call Signpost 2. And then eventually I wrote a history of the first 100 years of Milpitas, which always seems to get a laugh because Milpitas was kind of a vaudeville joke for many years, but it certainly isn't anymore. I mean, it's a big city. But anyway, in all of this history stuff, I was fortunate enough to be on the paper when San Jose celebrated its 100th anniversary as in connection with the first state capitol. And of course, I worked closely with Clyde on that. And you know, they built the state house, people built the state house with donated materials. And that's when the first real museum started. People brought in things from their attics and basements and put them on display in the replica of the state house on City Plaza. And then later it was moved out to the fairgrounds, and it is still out there. And Clyde was in charge of it, and I, you know, every chance I got, I was out there. I remember helping him sweep the floor, mop the floor one time. He put people to work because he was all by himself out there, and he needed help. But anyway, that was fun. And then when we moved over here, of course, I was interested and stayed in touch all the time, and I used to get wonderful stories from Clyde and from the people here when they would receive a collection of something or something of significance. Then I would write about where it came from and who the people were that gave it to them and that kind of thing. And I don't know, I just kept hoping that before 1949, when we had the centennial celebration, I had, you know, written articles about hoping for a museum, and And then we had the real break when we had all this collection and it needed to be put someplace. And then they bought this property, some very nice people put up the money to buy this property, and they did. And then later they bought this wonderful collection from Lou Bonnet, and it's out here. And so anyway, I've served on the development council, and I was on the museum association board briefly a long time ago. But I don't know. This is something that I've watched grow, and I've had input. I mean, I don't know how many people listen. Not too many, but I keep going off over it, and hopefully. They do listen, but it seems like forever. But then when you sit back and look, and just sitting here today, looking at the Chinese temple, and all these buildings that are here, they were not here 25 years ago. You know, we had a couple of warehouses where we stuffed all the stuff from the State House Museum, and. Then we started acquiring the doctor's office, and we built the hotel, the firehouse, and eventually, you know, you can begin to see that this is going to be a city, a town, you know, of its own. And you know, I really have to hand it to the people who have worked so hard out here. You know, I've just kind of gotten in their hair, I think, but. I think maybe that's not a bad thing. I think if you show interest, even though you may be off the wall, kind of, at least they think about it. And some of the things that I had hoped that would happen have happened. And I've been out here for 25 years, not maybe all the time, not as a volunteer that long, but. I've certainly been interested in the museum that long and longer, and I'm going to stay around for the next 25 to make sure that everything comes true. That's about all.
Okay, Judy, your very first involvement with the museum goes back to when did you start?
The bicentennial year, 1976. And my son, who was about 12 or 13 at that time, was writing an essay, a historical essay for a contest. And he wanted some primary materials. And I called the historical museum to see if they had any, and it turned out that after about 3 weeks they could get back to me and say yes, they did have some. And so we made an appointment for Dave and I to come over and pick up these things. Of course we couldn't take them, but we could look at them and read them. And so I came over, and as it turned out, at that time they had a policy where they didn't really get it until you showed up wanting it. I suppose that too many had been pulled that no one ever showed up for, but in any case. So I went in with the archivist. At that time was Claudia Germain, and you know, watched her climb to the highest rack and bring down a box of material and go through the box. And we started to talk about how difficult it was to find things in the archives, how many good things there were, but at that time it was very difficult. It wasn't a good system to find things that you needed. So I said to her in one of those moments that I didn't know much about archiving, but that I was a librarian and I did know about information retrieval, and I could probably learn a little about archiving, because she didn't know anything about it either and was working from a book. And I said, I'll come and I'll help, and you know, I'd like to do this, it'd be interesting. And so we agreed, and so I came once a week for about a year and a half. And I worked out in the buildings, non-air conditioned, trying to set up categories for archives, and generally enjoying reading the things that were there. My work in the archives that made me take docent training. I took it the next year, San Jose's bicentennial year, 1977. And I took it more for work in the archives than for really doing docent work. I'm not a San Jose native, and I didn't know enough local history to bring to my work in the archives. And so docent training, which was excellent, was a way of getting me ready to do better work in the archives. Then I had to go back to work full time. And so for a little bit of time, I wasn't involved here at the museum. I got a chance to go on the Landmarks Commission in 79 or 80. And I had friends on the commission already, a number of people who have been here at the museum were commissioners with me. And we all ended up continuing the love of the history of San Jose. And from there, my next involvement was when I ran for city council, and I was able to be a Landmarks Commission to the day I was sworn in on city council. And part of what I wanted to achieve when I was on council was some things for the museum and some things for the old buildings downtown, and a way of continuing to present local history in an interesting fashion that people might enjoy. And so council's a perfect place to do that from. There is no better place than the local city council with access to the local budget to do good work for historical preservation and other kinds of historical needs. And I was liaison to the museum and to the Museum Association and to the Landmarks Commission. And so my office was more of a central point for some of the things that were happening in the historical community. And Judy Henderson worked for me in my office and had as her assignment to be the person who generally was the one who actually attended the meetings, read the materials, and kept abreast of what was happening. She had more hands-on experience through those years than I did, but I had the most valuable piece, which was some access to city money. I served with was very sensitive to historic needs, which was wonderful. It was a time where we made great strides on a lot of preservation. It was a time of some additional money in the city budget in a way that hasn't been recently. And we were able to make some strides, and we did some good projects. And one of the projects that I was most involved in was the restoration of the Fallon House. We had had a historic committee, which a lot of people from the museum served on, which was called Plan for the Past. And the plan for the past was to try and get in front of issues, try and decide what our priorities were, and where, if we could find funding, what our top contenders for funding would be. And the top contender for funding that came out of the plan for the past was the Peralta Adobe, which had been finished and had been preserved by some people who really knew what they were doing and who did this community an enormous favor, because it is without a doubt the most important building in the city of San Jose. But it had never had full funding, and it was terribly underutilized. And so as we looked around for a way to make the Peralta Adobe more marketable, for lack of a better term, we decided that adding the Fallon House, which was directly across the street to it, would be then the beginnings of a historical concept. Both houses had an important historical past. The Fallon's not nearly as important as the Adobe, but both of them pretty important. And so we were able, since it was the first priority of the community that worked on Plan for the Past, we were able to get the money to purchase the Fallon House, which at that time was Manny's cellar. And Manny's was a great place, full of life, and is missed by the community. But we felt that just putting Peralta and Fallon together was a greater good. And so we went forward with that. And it was a really good project, and the council was all excited about it. And we got the biggest grant the state of California ever gave for a historical project to do the refurbishing of the Fallon House. I'm going to kill a lot of enthusiasm for the historical complex And then all of a sudden, a whole other issue came across the horizon, which was a statue of Thomas Fallon that was to be erected in the downtown at Plaza Park. And the Fallon statue became the biggest controversy of my whole time on City Council. Unbelievably, it was. And all of the political jazz came out of that project. And all of a sudden, the project was something of an orphan. And when it came time, after $5 million worth of construction on the house and some additional shoring up and refurbishing of the Adobe, the city manager brought out a budget that said there would be no staffing and that that project would not be open to the public. And after watching the Adobe be there for 20 years with such limited access, that was just not acceptable. And so I tried to work through my political colleagues to get the budget to reflect staffing, but I was unsuccessful, partly because it was a very, very bad year. We were making the biggest cuts we made in my whole 8 years on council. We were making the biggest staff cuts and the biggest cuts that we had ever made. And to take up the Fallon House and make it a priority when you're stopping mowing the lawn in city parks, it wasn't feasible. But at the same time, I wasn't content that we had now two wonderful buildings where maybe not a lot was going to happen. So I went to the retreat of the Museum Association in 1992. It was January of 1992. And I hadn't had a concept before I went to talk to them about the situation. But I happened to be in a little focus group that was talking about a gift shop or a presence in the downtown. And all of a sudden, one of my needs, and kind of a small need of the associations, I have to admit, but there were, both of us had needs at that moment. And this little thing popped in my mind. And in the middle of this group, I said, I can get you a gift shop downtown if you're willing to take over the Peralta, Adobe, and Fallon House. No one had heard about it before, not even my staff, because it had not been a concept before, and it just came naturally from this. We really want a downtown presence. We really, you know, it will be very good for the museum. It will, so many more people will know about the Kelley Park facility if we have something downtown. And so we were talking about it, and they asked me why, and I said because the city was not going to open it in that budget year, and that was my last time on council. And I really felt that if I left and there was no momentum in that project, that getting momentum for Captain Fallon's house was going to be an impossibility. So I needed to do something then. I wasn't sure what I would do, but I was making them the first offer. If the association would be interested in attempting to run the historical complex, then I wouldn't. Would you stop it? I need to drink. Well, I was just, you don't know. I have to hand it to the people who in that room. There was Jerry DeYoung, who was the incoming president, and Patty McDonald, who was the outgoing president. Of course, Kathy Muller, Mignon, a variety of people who had been, you know, so instrumental in moving the museum along. And I think they were sort of startled, but what I had to say was, I have to do something. So if it's not going to work for you, I will have to find another group. And if I can't find another group, I will have to found a group, because I know that the buildings will be mothballed if I don't. And so it was kind of, well, let us think about it. And I said, fine, think about it for a while, but, you know, don't take forever, because if I have to found a group, I need to get moving while I'm still on council. And over time and in small measure, it began to become an idea that the association saw that they could rescue a project that was tremendously important, and that if they didn't step in, was may not be able to go forward. And to their credit, and I will love them, us forever, They stepped up to the plate. They learned a lot of new things. They found the resources. They volunteered their own time. The staff at the museum helped us find resources that were already here. We found new resources. And Peralta Fallon took shape, and it became the right place to tell the earliest history of San Jose and to make it real. And I think everyone who had a piece of that is very proud of it and should be. And my colleagues on the council, the museum staff, but mostly the association and the people who were, Kathy, who was the director, and the people who held the high offices at that time, who really worked hard to make it happen.
Okay. Maybe about the bicentennial year, 1975, getting into the bicentennial year.
All right, well, I'll start with, it's a warm July afternoon, and I walk down the street and come to one of my favorite places, the Fallon House. It's been provided for former mayors as a place of tranquility where they can pick up one of their favorite books. I really love this author of this book here. And just kind of kick back and talk a little bit about San Jose and how it came to be. There are others that do it better than I, but I don't think there's anyone who maybe enjoys it quite as much as I do from the inside as well as the outside. And seeing the growth of the San Jose Museum and what the Museum Association has done over the last quarter of a century has been something that I've enjoyed very much as a citizen and during the time I had the honor to be mayor of San Jose. I guess I got involved a lot with this particular area of history and this geographic area where we sit today about the middle of the 1970s when Leonard McKay came over to my father and asked him if he'd be willing to head up an organization to restore the old Peralta Adobe. My father, being very wise, said he couldn't do it at this time, but how about having Tom do it? And Leonard jumped me very shortly after that, and I got involved with one of the most exciting things I've ever been involved in. I remember the Peralta Adobe walking by there many times and talking to old Mr. Baccio, who lived right in front of it in the old frame house. Baccio, to me, is one of the true heroes of San Jose. When others were forgetting about the past and really paid no attention to the important elements of continuity that we should pass on to our children and grandchildren and other generations, Mr. Baccio, although I don't think he could have told you the history of Manuel Gonzalez, the Apache Indian who built it, or Peralta, the first comisionado of San Jose, but he knew there was something very intrinsically valuable in that old building. And he took care of it when people in the city were frankly kind of asleep at the switch. And by the time Leonard McKay and others decided that it was time to restore the Peralta Adobe, well, Mr. Baccio had indeed done his important part of the work, and the rest of us kind of followed in. We raised a good deal of money, all from private individuals and people like Leonard McKay and Theron Fox and Clyde Arbuckle and, of course, the historian Frances Fox and so many others. Frank Cacuzza were invaluable in making sure that the Peralta Adobe took its place as one of the great educational treasures of our area. The Fallon House, with the good work of Judy Stabile and other people at City Hall, which had finally woke up a little bit to the importance of history, became, I think, just a wonderful 1-2 punch in historical continuity and educational resources. And anybody who doubts their value, all they have to do is sit around down here, as I occasionally do, and see the children's groups coming through and see the students getting a chance to understand exactly how San Jose came to be. I think we all know what Mr. Baccio knew instinctively, that these buildings are very important and what they signify is a singularly valuable thing to San Jose and to this entire region. I guess that same type of feeling that I get here is multiplied many-fold when we go out to the Historical Museum at Kelley Park. The volunteers that have worked so hard there, the Museum Association, and the things that they have done are little short of spectacular. You know, Silicon Valley is famous for startups, and in 25 years I have to think that the San Jose Historical Museum is one of the most successful startups that Silicon Valley has ever seen. I was very proud to support them as mayor. I'm very proud to support them as a citizen. It's a great place for an afternoon, and it's a great place to spend a whole week if you have the time. Where else do we go?
That's great. As we go into an exciting new future in the years to come? And
to the Museum Association, would you say, or to the museum?
Just do it to the museum.
Okay.
I think we'll be more politically correct, just because there will no longer be an association with a new nonprofit entity.
Yeah, I'll do it to the volunteers and the people that work out there, yeah. Yeah, okay. Just give me a 3-2-1 or something.
Okay.
San Jose Museum, the staff, the dedicated volunteers that make that place one of the great educational and historical treasures of this or any other locality. I really wish you good luck. I thank you for all the things that you've done, and I look forward to seeing your continued good works continue to grace this valley.
I'd like to welcome everybody to the San Jose Historical Museum. We're standing in front of one of my favorite projects, a replica of San Jose's Chinese temple that was originally built in 1881, but replicated by the Chinese community out here on our grounds of our historical museum. The museum is a fabulous place, and many people in the community have helped build it and make it what it is today. I'd like to invite all of you to come out and visit the Trolley Barn. Here tonight to celebrate the first 25 years of the San Jose Historical Museum on this site. And as we look forward to our next 25 years, we've got a foundation of tremendous community support and a lot of physical site improvements. The next 25 years, I hope, are ones of tremendous growth, tremendous community support, and fine-tuning the great historical museum that we've started here. One of the first projects in the next few years is the moving of our archives to an appropriate site across the street, and we also have the opportunity to move our collections. We have many projects on the books, and we look forward to opening them to the public and having great events and great activities out here. Let's take this opportunity to remember the past, celebrate the accomplishments of today, and look forward to working together to building a better future for the history museums of San Jose.
I first became involved here at the Historical Museum in 1980, about 16 years ago. I took the docent training class. I'd read about it in the paper, and my youngest child had just gone to kindergarten, so I had a few hours to myself every morning and thought I would like to do something that I knew I would enjoy, and so I took docent training. And for about 2 years, I gave tours of the museum, mostly to school children, to third and to fourth graders, but to the general public as well. During that time, I was also asked to be on the Association Board of Directors. I served on that board for probably less than a year when the board was faced with a fairly momentous decision. The effects of Proposition 13 had hit the city of San Jose and other cities throughout California, and the funding that had been in place for since the beginning of the museum seemed to just evaporate. And we dropped from 11 full-time city staff people to 2. The museum was left with a full-time director and a secretary and nobody else to assist in keeping the doors open, much less, you know, all the other programs that people wanted to see happen. So the association board at that time came to the conclusion that they were going to have to take on a different role than they had previously. Prior to 82, 83, the association had been a social support group for the museum, had operated the membership program and done parties for the openings of exhibits and things like that. But it was decided at that point that the association would try to fund 3 part-time staff positions to help keep the doors of the museum open until more stable funding could be found at a later date. And I was one of the three people that was hired at that time. A docent coordinator was hired, a curator, and my position was titled administrator, and my job was to actually build up the association as an organization, to work on the development of the membership program, to see that the quarterly, which became a bi-monthly newsletter, would get out on a regular basis, and to start to develop different programs that would bring more of the community into the museum, more community support, so that we would be able to grow and continue. I started at 16 hours a week. That 16 grew to, I think, 24, then 36, and several years later I was working full time. Probably the biggest change that I see as I sit here today is the physical development that has occurred in the last 10 years. About 1986 or so, the Museum Association entered into a special partnership relationship with the city, whereby we worked with the city Department of Architectural Engineering, and using in some cases city funds, but also association funds and private grant monies, we moved a number of buildings onto this site and restored those that we moved on, plus several others that have been sitting here for some time unrestored since the city funding had disappeared. One of the buildings in particular that we did restore that I think I'm proudest of is the Stevens Ranch Fruit Barn, which is right here behind me. This fruit storage shed had actually been moved from a South County location when the Highway 101 bypass was going in. And it had been moved here to the site and was actually in place in 1980 when I first came here. But there was no exhibit in it. It wasn't yet open to the public. And one of the things that the Museum Association did was actually coordinate the restoration of this building, turned it into museum climate controlled space, and worked with Yvonne Jacobson, who was the author and designer of the exhibit Passing Farms, Enduring Values, that is a history of the small family farm in the Santa Clara Valley. And with Yvonne's great help and cooperation, we actually had that exhibit installed here in the Stevens Ranch Fruit Barn. Let's walk inside now. Maybe we could take a look at that exhibit that I was talking about that Yvonne created. One of the things that was most challenging about the restoration of this building was that we wanted to maintain the look and the feel of the barn, the fruit storage shed, but at the same time we wanted to have climate controlled space so that the exhibit that Yvonne had created would be protected. I'm really pleased with our success in doing that. Her exhibit consists of photographic panels, and text, and then throughout it, it is enhanced by cases with artifacts that talk about the agricultural industry, the fruit packing industry that was such a large part of the history of this valley. Many people that I've spoken to who grew up and worked here in the orchards and in the canning industry have said how nostalgic this exhibit is for them, that it really brings back to many of them the experiences they had as a child working in their parents' orchard or in some industry related to the canning business. So this is one of my favorite exhibits, and because I think that it really speaks to the importance of this industry to what our history was here for so many years and is such an important part of the legacy that we have. One of the more interesting parts of the exhibit for me too is this area over here that is an exhibit of fruit canning labels. Many of them came to us from the Murison canning label, and some of them were designed by a man by the name of Ralph Rambo, who I had the pleasure of knowing for several years. Ralph was actually the author of a number of books on the history of the Santa Clara Valley that he hand-lettered and wrote initially for his grandchildren and then for the enjoyment of everybody else. Ralph had spent his entire adult career at Murison Label Company as an artist designing fruit labels. And there's just some really interesting history in these labels. Years and years ago, they did not have to picture what was in the can, and so many of the labels actually depict historical scenes, and you'll see Mount Hamilton and other natural attractions from the Santa Clara Valley on these beautiful labels. As the years went by, you can see the way the laws changed and how important it became to list the ingredients and to actually picture what was inside the can. But I think some of the older labels in particular contain a lot of individual family histories. Different brand names were named after families, named after people's children and grandchildren, and after important places here in the Santa Clara Valley. So they present a wonderful history, I think, of this valley in a microcosm, as well as a real history, again, of a portion of the canning industry. I'm really proud and pleased that I had actually 16 years that I was directly involved with the museum and with the Museum Association. I think that we've just made tremendous strides in all of the last 25 years, and I really think that the future is very bright. My wish is certainly that this museum becomes a real regional attraction. I think that it has the potential to do that, and I wish the whole museum community well in achieving that goal.